Here comes the news. There's no time to lose. Ooh, 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 ooh. I'm kind of hiding here, out here from the sun. It's blasted over here. I'm over here, but there is no time to lose right now. I could do a lot of very artful kind of videos. Who knows if I do those or not. The concepts are certainly there. It's possible. But right now we have to take care of business here. And actually, I forgot to turn on the lights here. That's how much of a hurry I am in. We should be in a hurry. We should be in a big hurry right now without forcing things. Taking care of business, getting ready for, there is a global mental health alert issued, and this is serious, serious business. So I am gearing up for this, and let us see what we can do here. Let us see what we can do. Now, I assert that I've been contacted by a mental health expert, Longchenpa, the great Nyingma master, great Buddhist master. So the question would be, well, why were you contacted? And I asked myself that. It's like, huh. But there's an easy answer. It's I know how to practice. I know how to practice in the right way. And that's the answer. Because in order to be helpful, one has to be able to maintain and go with the flow and be flexible and all this. You need real good mental health, which comes from right practice. So I wasn't contacted because of how smart I was, how much I knew, charisma, how heartful I was, all these different reasons. It's just because I know how to practice in the right way. This is what these Dharma kings, these great mental health giants, are looking for. This is the key attribute that they look for. This. Do you know how to practice in the right way? Do you know how to practice? Can you practice? Can you bring yourself on the fly in the turmoils of life? Can you keep your stability, keep your direction? Keep your integrity, continue to move forward, get better, improve, be more helpful. Can you do that in the midst of great surprises and shifts all over the place? Which is what happens here, is happening, will happen. Now, the truth is, as I'm looking at hindsight, that very few know how to practice in the right way, and it seems to be something that can hardly be taught. I wasn't taught it. I just, out of sheer desperation, I had to get free of my suffering. So I had to find what worked. So I just never stopped trying, and gradually you begin to recognize and somehow find out how to practice in the right way. But I haven't been able to seem to impart this to others. I haven't had any feedback about success about that, even though that seems to be all that I do, is I say you have to know how to practice properly, full stop in the wow. There's different ways of, people have different terms, I understand that. Some can say a balanced mind, a neutral mind, mindful mind. There's various ways to say it. But it really is something that has to be mastered. One has to be very good at it. and how you're good at it by applying it. It's not academically, I understand what it's about. It's actually doing it. So Longchamp is looking for someone who's actually doing this. Who's actually doing it continuously, really into it, just to stay on their board. You know, you don't want to wipe out. You don't want to take a great fall, as I just recently did. But it was instructive. I found out that you hit one side of the body, guess what? It's very odd. The other side of the body starts hurting too. So I hurt my right hip. You know what was hurting more now? My left hip. But I didn't hit my left hip. My left knee was hurting for a while. I didn't touch it. The left side was okay. Yet it's hurting. And isn't that odd? And so also the inflammation and irritation spread throughout the whole body. I just talked to somebody who had a hip replacement, and they said the same thing. They said my whole body just felt horrible, like I was just so sick. And it spreads throughout, becomes non-localized. This is a great instruction for the troubles in the world, how troubles one place can cause everybody in the world to feel agitated. This is very true, especially with the social media we have now, information age and social media. So don't think we can just localize troubles in the world anymore. Doesn't seem to work that way at all, does it? Now, in order to make brisk progress, you have to have breakthroughs. And in order to have breakthroughs, you have to know how to handle your success. In order to handle your success, you have to know how to practice in the right way. And then you have to actually do it. So I always harp upon this. It's central to anyone's success is to keep focusing on how can I practice in the right way? How can I, when this information comes up, what do I do? Wow. The term wow is a great term. I advise everyone to use this. You wow your life, continuously wow it. Get more and more in the habit of that. And then you'll notice there are times when something occurs that is so amazing, you don't want to make any decision on it one way or the other. You don't want to analyze it. You just say, wow, this happened to me today. It's so amazing. And these things will happen for you. The better you get at practicing, the more amazing grace becomes. And so this was just another facet of the amazing grace of Longchenpa. The second time I met him, the first time, I can't 100% for sure say it was him, but I believe it was, because he spoke in a highly spiritual, advanced way, but I couldn't understand anything he was saying. I just said, this is a completely different way. I don't get it. As most likely it was him. And he said he'd like me to offer me a job at some point. And I said, am I really, you know, I don't know if I'm really even good for that. Good job. If I have a job, I want to do a really great job. I don't know if I could do a great job. So I said, well, I'll give it serious consideration. It may have been him. And the second time, well, for sure it was him. And he came in the dream. I saw this man walking across this ocean, on top of the ocean. He's walking on water. And he walked all the way across this ocean to me. Walked up on the beach, just, and then completely casually, like he hadn't done anything amazing at all. This is just completely normal for him. Well, I understand now that ocean is the ocean of samsara, the ocean of maya, the ocean of delusion, sin. And his walking upon it means that he can come into the world here without sinking down into maya, self-delusion, without sinking down into the waters of self-deception. That's what it means. So the entrance that he made was just astonishing. And then I asked him, what was it, the water, was it warm, or was it warm, or was it cool? And he said, it's both. Meaning he doesn't draw a differentiation between good modification and bad modification, meaning he's above duality. He understands that the Maya, samsara, is this dualistic delusion. that good nothing is better than bad nothing. If you want to say that, it seems really funny, doesn't it? But that's literally what we're doing. We're saying, well, I'm really working towards good nothing, and you're going towards bad nothing. You know, this is better. We're really evolving good nothing. We want to keep evolving that good nothing. We don't want, you know, the bad nothing. We don't want problems from the bad nothing. And Guru Vision is just realizing that nothing is nothing. There's no good and bad nothing. There's no duality to nothing. How can there be? Ask yourself this question. Pose this question to yourself, or just affirm this question. See, affirmed questions are not being done for the purpose of an answer. We're just making an affirmation in the guise of a question. This softens it all for us. So, how can there be duality to nothing? How can nothing have a dual nature? How can nothing have a dual nature? Now, so this is how my day goes, like this. I will put a question, affirm it like this. How can nothing have duality, good and bad nothing? How is that possible? I won't answer it. I don't try to answer it. I don't try to do anything with it. I just keep posing this question to myself, question like that. And then I do a slow burn. I don't try to go anywhere with it, do anything with the question. Just hang out with it. Don't try to answer it. Either negatively or affirmatively, don't try to answer, just let it be. You see, we don't need to try and come up with any answer. What we do here is we trust it. We trust that that our true identity has native intelligence, has all the intelligence it needs. Truth is self-evident. So all we're doing is we're pointing out to ourselves the obvious. And getting used to the obvious. That's all. We're just getting used to the obvious. Beautiful day here in California again, like dream weather. Dreamland here. All the lotus eaters are out here enjoying the weather. So this is called right practice. You see something profound, you know it's profound. You don't need to say anything more about it. Just get used to the profundity of it. Just stay quiet. No struggle. Don't anticipate. Don't remember. Don't anticipate. Now, don't peek around mentally. Don't peek mentally. There's more intense practices. We've done many of them. I did one last night and this morning. Extraordinary. But it's all the same. When you really hit the nail on the head, you know you hit the nail on the head. It's inescapable at that point. This changes your life. Just seeing that changes your life. Your life will never be the same again. This is the truth. It changes your pretend life, rather. Your investment in delusion becomes less. It's not like our true identity can be changed, but our investment in pretending that we're something other than what we are, which we call the I, it's just a pretend. We're just pretending. Our investment gets a lot less. We're divesting ourselves of that. So we just we're not trying to do anything. I'm not trying to be silent. I'm not trying to still the mind. I'm not trying to do this. I'm not trying to do anything. Just let it sink in that I'll never be the same. And just accept it deep down. This is what really happens. I've never heard anyone mention this. It's amazing to me how poor meditation instruction has been, from my opinion. You get these sages that blah blah blah. They say great stuff, but yeah, but that's not where it's at. You can get any book, so many books you could go and read it, That's not where it's at. Where it's at is you accepting that your life has been changed, that your pretend life, your investment in your pretend life has been greatly diminished. And this is quite a shock. Because this pretend life, we think it's necessary. If we don't have it, we're going to be cast into an abyss. At least that's our fear. So it's a very frightening, it can be, well, it's a very, it gets our attention at a deep level. So when we have these breakthroughs, when we say this non-dual truth, we have to understand that whatever we're experiencing superficially isn't important. That deep down, we are very, very shocked by this. Because we think that our defenses are impenetrable, or they're perfect, you know. And to see that we can actually glimpse this, see that, is astonishing to us. We thought we'd never be able to see that again. I thought I would never recover from this pretense. And you experience, you say, I'm starting to recover from it. This is so amazing. And deep down, it really rattles your cage. But you may not, on the surface, you may not be aware of it. It's like an underwater earthquake, deep water earthquake. You may think, oh, it's no big deal. Nothing's happened to the ocean. Well, once that energy hits the land, it's a tsunami. And all sorts of stuff happens then. So you have to be ready for the tsunami that's coming, that's being generated by your deep reaction. And most of us just gloss this over. This is the heart of success, is to not gloss it over. It is to be proactive and proactively anticipate it. It doesn't matter how you're feeling superficial. Pay no attention to that, a little scant attention. You know, you just saw something, glimpse, affirmed, pose this question to yourself that is extremely profound. How can nothing have a dualistic nature to it? And this registers at a very, very deeply in your core of your defenses, and it shakes it like a huge earthquake, actually. So again, imagine you're triggering these underwater earthquakes, and you may be on a boat fishing, and you might feel like just, you know, little something, the ocean rises a little by, you know, a little bit, but that's about it. You think, nothing really much happened. But the massive amount of energy was released by that earthquake, displacement of so much water overall, that the energy spreads out, and as it comes towards shallow water, all that energy, all that momentum builds up, suddenly builds up, and there's a massive inflow of water, okay, once it gets to land. So landfall is like our superficial functioning. So we have to get to higher ground. When we trigger this psychic quake within us, we have to get to higher ground here. So you head for the hills. Of sitting quietly like this, you head for the hills. You be proactive. You don't wait until the tsunami hits the beach. You say, okay, I feel I've had this great breakthrough. This is very profound. I'm getting to higher ground right now. Because this, again, has radically altered our investment in delusion. Through and through. So we're very good at superficially pretending. You must not believe in this superficial reactions of, oh, I don't need to do much, I feel fine. Just like somebody, you know, there's a big underwater earthquake, somebody's on the beach in Hawaii, they say, oh, well, nothing's happened to the water. The water, the ocean looks fine here. Nah, shouldn't be much of a trouble. Shouldn't, you know. It's going to be some trouble for you, for sure. When you get to higher ground, though, and it comes in where you're at, nothing is, you're not bothered anymore. So as we're sitting here, anticipating not doing anything, I'm just going to sit here like this, and I'm not going to do anything. I'm not going to. So when it comes in, and eventually, you know, the tsunami comes in, then the water goes out, and then it's over with. And then things get back to normal. So when it comes in, I'm just going to, you know, just sit quietly. I'm not going to do anything. I'm not going to try and function in some way in particular. Just be quiet. Just sit here. When you do this, without trying to force anything in any direction, you will find after a while, suddenly you'll start having this reaction, like maybe your heart, your body feels like pulsing a little bit, like some sort of intensity arises, not an energy thing, but just sort of a felt intensity thing. Like, oh, it suddenly got so intense. What is that? Well, that's the delayed reaction. That's what's welling up. Your deep psyche, that we try to distance ourselves from our deep psyche, you know, it's really shaken up. So this is what Longchenpa is looking for. This is what the Dharma Kings look for. Do you know how to practice in the right way? Are you proactive in this way? And if you are, then guess what? You can get to all these breakthroughs and insights more and more and more and more, because you know, oh, I got to what? Another one? Okay, head for the hills. And take it easy. Let it subside. Let it all settle down. Don't be in a hurry. This is what's called right practice. And I'm not trying to do anything, a yoga thing or, you know, visualization thing. I'm not doing any of that. Never have. I'm just being patient and letting this, the inner upwelling of nervousness and wowness, it's like, wow, just letting that naturally subside. Don't be in a hurry, just be patient. You may get in a hurry, like, okay, I think I'm good. I don't feel I'm good right now. I can feel the intensity. That's why you must not use coffee. You must not use drugs in this practice. You cannot. That's another thing that the gurus look for. No drugs. You can't practice right if you use drugs. You cannot. Because you will not be able to properly evaluate the intensity within you. You can't differentiate what's the intensity from the caffeine and what is from the upwelling in my psyche. This irretrievable shift in investing in pretense. You won't be able to tell the difference, so you don't know, you know, when to really full stop in the wow, when to ease off of it. And you think it might be going on longer than you expected, because if you're, you have caffeine, it might go on much longer than it should. Because it's being masked and the caffeine is still active. Or, you know, all this stuff. This is what they look. They say, is someone absolutely sober in doing this? Yes. And you don't flee into some sort of addictive behavior to try to mask this upheaval. No sex, no drugs, no rock and roll. You just sit here quietly. You let the upheaval take place. You let it just naturally arise. There's some intensity to it. Deep intensity is different than superficial intensity. Some people seem to be very calm on the surface. Inside, they're seething. You know, their deep intensity is just like, wow. So I'm a strict brahmacharya. Stay sober in every way. So that I'm always aware of how am I feeling. What's the relation between the deep psyche and the superficial? And where am I at in terms of breakthroughs? I always monitor. You have to monitor how you feel in just a general way. You can't lose touch with it. Not like I'm obsessively every this. No. It's just a general awareness, like I've got to be conservative here. I have to play it conservative. So I'm quite conservative. It's very important. I favor a conservative society, conservative values, because it's helpful. It has a whole bunch of helpful aspects to it, whereas a progressive society is way too overconfident. They tend to ignore all this dynamic, and they say no, and they push themselves with sex, drugs, and rock and roll to just try to override the whole thing, and it's reckless. It's spiritually reckless. It really is. You cannot be in too much of a hurry to make progress. You must be very sober, non-frivolous, but you can be very full of humor. That's fine. That's not necessarily frivolousness. I'm able to be humorous, but in a profound way. It's fine to be humorous in a profound way. It's great. We need more of that. So here it is, Friday afternoon. People are making plans for the weekend. This is that. I'm here taping like this, sharing right practice with you, and experiencing the wow. So I feel, it's not overwhelming by any means. I just feel like, wow, I don't really feel like doing anything right this moment, except just sitting here. Now, well, so far so good. I don't want to push things in too many different directions here. It's just simple. It's really simple. This is what the Dharma kings, the great gurus, are looking for. Is who's actually doing the right practice, not who is professing it, who is doing it. Who's it's meant to be applied. It's meant to be applied. All right. Meant to be applied here. So many might think we're not doing much of anything. We're just kind of sitting here like this. Now we're engaged in the best practice there is. The most effective, best practice there is. The safest practice. There's a lot of wow to it because you just realized you just took a step that irreversibly altered your whole investment in pretense, pretending to be that there's some sort of dynamic to pretending other than pretending. This is how the pickle that we're in, the trouble we're in, is we believe that there's some sort of dynamic to pretense. There's all these dynamics. Independent dynamics. There's none. Independent dynamics to pretending. What is that? There's another question. What is that? So posing these questions to ourselves is a very profound practice. We don't have to answer them. Just pose the question. That's enough because deep down we realize, oh wow, my defenses are crumbling. Because these are key defenses that we're simply just noticing, say, hey, wait a minute. That's all. We're not attacking it or anything. We just say, hey, wait a minute here. We're not so fast. What are these dynamics that we're talking about? Pretense. Is when we pretend, what are the dynamics involved in that, other than pretending? Are there some other dynamics at play? Are there some other dynamics at play? So I can speak about this because I already have been wowing it all day today, and with other along with other big wows, huge. So you know, some of the upheaval has lessened, but when I do it again, it brings up more. Because this is just the crumbling of delusion, really. It's not holding up at all. Now, we're not digging in to see how do we feel about it. Absolutely not. We're just getting to this higher ground of full stop in the wow, and let whatever comes up, whatever the tsunami's like, you just let it happen and then let it subside. You're not drawing any conclusions or judgments or anything. But you know you really caused an earthquake, a deep sea earthquake, when you ask this, pose this question of what sort of dynamics are there to pretending, other than pretending, what are the dynamics that we think are in play? Are there some other dynamics at play? Do we need to deal with some other dynamics other than we're just pretending? What dynamics? Dodge Challenger. Someone gave me the whole rundown today. Dodge Challenger, muscle car rundown here for you as we're hanging out here at high ground. We've got to high ground. And you just stay there. You just stay there. And then we might stay here. You know, we don't have a time frame. But what we have touched upon is so touchy. Is so touchy that this is just our, you know, inner defenses that are crumbling. So we're in no hurry to come back down, you know. We're going to stay where we are for a while and let it settle, let the dust settle. This is the whole technique, is you willing, it starts out with your willingness to get to higher ground, full stop in the wow, let the dust settle. And then once you have that willingness, you start your practice, and something will come up. You will hit upon something that is very profound. It will arise for you, no doubt about it. And then you employ this full stop on the wow as your defenses, as just reactions, and let the reactions die down. And you're just going to stay out of the mess. You know, So, muscle car rundown here, folks. Muscle cars are taking the USA by storm. I talked to someone who's really into the whole scene, and racing is all over the place at night. So many races are taking place. And I asked him, and he said on weekends we go out and push our cars to the, you know, really push them, meaning they're speedy, they're going fast. I mean, he said these cars are amazing. Talk about the Dodge Challenger. And I said, what do you mean by amazing? He said, how fast they are and how smooth. And I said, what do you mean by how fast? He says, well, I've gone 160, and it still feels smooth, very smooth. You don't even know you're going 160 again. He's like, I said, what? Yeah, I said, what? Where'd you do 160? He said, on a country road. So they're going out into these country roads driving these muscle cars now. It's amazing what's going on. It's a real cultural trend, actually. So I'm just aware of the cultural trend. I'm getting some information from people. Here's the rundown. The basic Dodge Challenger, stock Dodge Challenger, basic one you get, was the LE or the LX, something like that. It's a six-cylinder. It's a non-Hemi engine. The next step up is the eight-cylinder engine. It's a Hemi engine. Okay, so it's called the Dodge Hemi. It's a Hemi engine. Then you get the, it may be called the RT. I believe that the eight-cylinder is called the RT, or that may be, it's the Hemi RT. No, it's just a Hemi. And then there's the RT, I believe. The RT is got more power. It's faster. And then there's the Dodge Challenger RT. There's a Scat Pack, you call it. I think Scat Pack. And that hops up the RT a whole nother level. And it gets it closer to the Dodge Challenger uh 392, what's it called, SRT, the SRT, 3.2 Hemi SRT, which is, I think, like about 500 horsepower or something or more. Now, and then above that is the Hellcat, which is about 750 horsepower. And so I talked to someone who's been in a Hellcat when they're going really fast, and he's driven a SRT, and he's driven an RT, I believe. So he's been in these cars. He's been in all of these cars. And he says they are just insanely fast. Light, powerful, fast, just unbelievable. So I'm getting feedback from people that it's pretty amazing. It's very intoxicating, these cars. This is going on in the United States. This is really growing. Young people are loving these new muscle cars that are coming out that are just so powerful, and they have 8-speed automatic. 8-speed, that the shifting is such that it's super smooth and quick. Very, very quick cars. Now, I would say for me, it's just too quick. It's too quick. You don't want it to be that quick, okay? You don't want to have a car that's overly quick. I talked to this older man who has an SRT, which is 392 Hemi. It's a monster, and he said it's almost too much car because it's too quick. It's too quick. It gets on. If you want to accelerate, it gets on the car in front of you, and just so fast, you can hardly blink, and you're there. That's how quick it is. Which brings up a whole nother subject, which is smartness. Getting fast results. What is smartness? How to get fast results? Isn't this what materialism has engendered? Smartness. We all want to be smarter. Why? Get faster results. Better, faster results. This is what materialism is. It fosters this. This is the education system. It's all about, okay, you got a time test. Who's able to get the answers faster? Right answer, but I got faster, faster, faster. Boom. We want to make everything faster, more quicker results, more efficiency, more stuff. Like, this is what's going on. Now, this gives rise to an extreme problem. And this is the problem we're facing in the world. This is why we're facing a global mental health crisis, is that smartness that we think is so wonderful. This is this pretend I that we're pretending. Spirit is pretending to be something else, pretending to be this other self, this I. And this I is supposedly very smart, is able to, very clever, very quick, able to do all sorts of stuff faster and faster and faster, which is what we have in the world today. Everybody's very smart, very quick. They have smartphones for smart people. But what I have found through terrible experience of my own, I was born a genius. I was very fast and quick, very smart. Now, listen to this. Very, very important. There is a problem we have called the continuity fear problem, familiarity problem, which carries with it continuity fear. And this is a very insidious problem. We have been pretending that there's this other self, the I, for so long that we're so familiar with it, we can't imagine not pretending this. We think that there's, it's no longer pretense. There's dynamics to it. That this pretend I is governed by all these dynamics we call nature, we call the universe. We believe that this pretending to be an I, like pretending to be a cripple, I pretend to be a cripple, and we think that this cripple is governed by nature, by all these dynamics, and therefore it has to work out within the context of all these so-called dynamics, instead of realizing that we could instantly stop pretending, right? We're just pretending 100%. There's no dynamics that need to be waited upon. We need to wait for. But we're so used to that. The notion of dropping this pretense is just freaks us out. Freaks us out. We don't realize how severe the problem is. Nobody does. I do now, to a large extent. I guess still not going to say to to a total extent, but to a large extent, I realize it is so severe, this problem, and there is no way in the world that smartness is going to resolve this problem quickly. Yet the whole premise of smartness is quickness. So how long do people spend on trying to do something? A minute or two. You know, maybe I tried it for 10 minutes. Okay, I got it. Or I didn't get it. I didn't get it. Okay. This is smartness. It's geared to only spend a short time, as short as possible time on anything. So, you know, let's make manufacturing quicker, quicker, quicker. Everything is, we've geared ourselves for speed and efficiency, speed and efficiency, speed and efficiency. We've turned out, 1,000 widgets per hour. What are we focused on? We want to get 10,000 an hour out somehow. So we have almost no patience for waiting on anything anymore. And if we don't get quick results, we just drop it. We just drop it. Say, okay, that's not it. So how do you think this plays out with tackling this continuity fear, this all-important fear? It's really the only problem we have. It holds everything in place, all our pretense. It holds it in place. It's an insidious, shadowy problem that seems to be impervious to any sort of quick solution. So here I am, a genius, thinking, okay, I should be able to solve this really quickly. I was very fast and quick in solving problems. Boom, 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 boom. People said, wow, you're some kind of genius. This is unbelievable how fast you are. Super fast. Super, super quick in coordination and stuff too. And so I said, okay, well, all right, there's a problem. Okay, I should be able to get it. Let's see. I expect to get this solved in a matter of, seconds. And seconds didn't work. I said, oh, a couple minutes. I'll try a couple minutes. That didn't work. I said, that's really weird. It's really weird. And don't know what to make of it. Now, what happens is what smartness does when it can't solve a problem, when it can't solve a problem quickly, which is the only way smartness functions, is quick. How quick can I do it? And it suffers if it doesn't do it quickly. It feels suffering, misery, like, that's terrible. I should have done it faster. When it can't solve this continuity problem, make it go away, what does it do? It does a little trick, because it wants to make the problem go away, so what does it do? It ignores it, and it thinks it makes it go away that way. It says, well, if I just pretend it doesn't exist, it'll go away, it'll be gone. And so this is what smartness counsels us to do, is simply ignore this problem. And it believes, it hopes, that if we just ignore it long enough, yeah, it'll get tired, of being ignored and just wander off and disappear. Be gone. This is its strategy, is just ignore this problem. So it cannot solve quickly to its standards of quickness, and it tries and tries, it can't solve it. Then what it does, it ignores it. This is what smartness does. So you have a world right now that's totally ignoring this issue, because we have a world of smart people, which is the worst kind of world possible, actually. Because they have a world full of those who simply just ignore this continuity fear problem. And they say, no, I'll just focus on what I can fix real quickly. But this continuity fear problem is actually the root of all problems. It actually holds us, binds us to all these problems. When we evaporate this continuity fear problem, which is how you have to do it, you have to evaporate it, because it's a question not of solving it, but a question of familiarity. Then all the other problems go along with it. They all evaporate. The root's gone. The others wither away without us having to do anything about it. So you can see how a world full of smart people is the worst kind of world there is. It is a world headed for disaster. Psychological disaster. Just ignoring this continuity problem, guess what? It compounds it. Because we continue to do the very things that make reason and truth seem like a severely threatening to us and make reality seem like an abyss. So we just keep compounding it by ignoring it. And again, we start putting our hope in luck. The more you ignore this continuity issue, this continuity problem, the more you start falling into believing in luck and shrewdness, and maybe they will be affected but not me, become selfish, and all this whole host of defenses. You get sucked into all this stuff because you say, I don't want to not be smart. Smart's super, but it's all important. That's what I am. I'm a smart Homo sapien. I'm a smart Homo sapien. I'm a smart human, and you feel that this is your identity. And so, in not being able to solve this continuity, fear, familiarity problem quickly, we feel like we're losing our identity. Well, oh, I'm falling. I'm regressing. This is terrible. So then we just take the tact of ignoring it, ignoring it. And this is exactly what happens to everybody here. Now, for me, I was suffering so terrible, I couldn't ignore it. I said, I got to get a remedy for this suffering right now, and I can't stop until I get it. So I want it right now, but if it takes all day, I'm going to get it. So every day I said, if it takes all day, I'm going to work on this problem all day long, if that's what it takes. I hope I get it in a few minutes, but if not, I'm just not going to stop until I get it. And this was my attitude every day, still is. I'm going to work all day long as if I'm going to get it this very next minute. I'm going to have it. And then I just keep that going all day long. Maybe this minute, maybe this minute, maybe this minute. Just don't stop. So in doing that, you still feel, smart. You're trying to solve it quickly, but you're just not giving up when it fails to solve it quickly, because you think, well, I should be able to get it the next moment, and I should be able to get it the next moment. So you don't have to attack yourself, your smartness, and all that. You just have to use it in a truly wise way. And especially rein it in terms of full stop on the wow. You just leave that smartness aside for a while. But you're being smart. But you're being smart in doing that. So you kind of redefine what smart is a little bit. It's not what you're taught in school at all. Our education is so ruinous for our dropping the pretense. We talk about ruinous. We can't ruin what we are at all. But in terms of dropping our pretense, it can be ruinous. In terms of it'll keep our bondage to pretense going, maybe for a long while. We can keep it going indefinitely, actually, our bondage to pretense, thinking there's some sort of process that has dynamics have to play out in order for the pretense to the I to become something that we really are proud of. So this is great. Great I. We have a great I here. So again, in a world where which worships smartness, that world's headed for a great fall. There's a saying, pride goeth before a fall. So before the fall comes the pride. Pride in what? In smartness. So here comes the fall. Here comes the fall. In more ways than one. We're headed into the autumn fall. It may be the fall and the fall. It may be the fall and the fall. It's amazing how the younger generation is into quickness. It's the end all and be all of everything, beyond just normal youthfulness. It's obsession with quickness. And this has this greatly negative backlash of not being, you know, getting real flustered and upset that you can't solve the continuity fear, familiarity problem just through some sort of smartness. And then ignoring it. And believing that, therefore, that ignoring this basically means ignoring our mental health. So what we do in this world is we ignore our mental health. Who is taught to tend to their mental health properly? Who's minding the store of mental health? Who is doing that? Virtually no one, except for the Dharma kings and those who assist them. I've been an amateur, you know, mental health is my hobby, because my own mental health was in such bad shape, because I tried to overcome the continuity fear, and I couldn't do it. And I got all, you know, stressed out, and I was trying to help everyone. I was trying to help the world after the JFK assassination. All the adults, everybody freaked out, and the golden age was gone. I tried to bring back the golden age, you know. So what's wrong with these people? How can I help them? So then I tried to optimize myself so I could help them. And in trying to optimize myself, I came across this continuity fear problem. And then I tried to, you know, figure out how to get rid of this quick, and I couldn't figure it out. So then I started going through this tailspin. Resulting in anxiety, severe anxiety, you know, in exhaustion, we call it depression. You go into a tailspin because you want to help so much, and you're not, you exhaust yourself trying to help, actually. This is the problem. People who go into depression are often very, very wonderful people who truly want to help others, but they can't find how to do it. And in trying to do it, they run up against this continuity fear problem, and then they desperately try to fix that, and they can't fix it, and they can't get rid of it, and then they try to ignore it, you know, and commotions and turmoils arise, and they sink into great tiredness and depression. And I know exactly what that's all about. So the cure to depression is to recognize the continuity fear and accept that it's a very severe problem. It's a familiarity problem. It does not yield to smartness. It only yields to steady determination with right practice. That's it. So you may not be able to help everybody right away, but in the long term, you will be able to. So you have to realize that. And assassinations are a terrible thing of political leaders, because it plunges people into long-term depression, especially the younger people. I'm very concerned about the younger people right now, their mental health, because younger people, they depend on the adult infrastructure, and if they see the adult infrastructure all dysfunctional, that really scares them. And so they want to try and make older people feel better and say, hey, you know, what can I do to help you function better? And, you know, I don't know. I feel, you know, everything's messed up. Ah. And the kids then try to say, okay, let me optimize myself. And especially the sensitive, compassionate kids. And this, then they'll tailspin into depression, what they call depression, and then antidepressants. And this is rampant in the world right now, absolutely rampant. Now, A Course in Miracles set me on the right path. I realized this is the right path. I don't need antidepressants. I don't need this medicine. I don't need anything. This is going to work. The other stuff doesn't work. The psychiatrists, the psychologists, they kind of know a little bit. Like, they got the hold of the tail of the elephant. There's something here. So they're kind of staggering around the issue. They stagger around it. They don't really understand it, but they recognize the symptoms, and they tell you, look, don't try too hard to make everybody happy. So they kind of address, they're able to address it in a superficial way, which can be superficially helpful. And that's why they had to start using antidepressants, because they couldn't really cure depression in the talk therapy way. It didn't seem to yield very well. People used to just self-medicate, you know, through drinking or war or whatever. They would, but as society changes in the modern world, these problems arise more and more. People would just take leave, go somewhere else. I mean, there are all sorts of ways we try to deal with it. But when you're stuck in a job at a city, and you really can get very depressed, actually. And so they've been trying to, talk therapy didn't really do the great job. So they say a combination, talk therapy and medication. And that's the best they've come up with. It's the best they've come up with. Well, that ain't very good. So you would need to add on to that genuine insight, genuine practice, and accept the fact that the adults, I know it's tough, I still can't hardly accept it, that the older people, those of you, they're not getting well. They're likely not to get well. They become permanently fixated and disturbed and locked into their personality patterns, and you know, there's not much you can do about it, actually. It's very difficult to accept. I still try. The world, the United States, particularly, is in an ominous position. It's a potential mental health crisis, actually. And if you understand how it develops, is people who depend on others, when those others are becoming dysfunctional and unhappy due to sudden having the rug pulled out from underneath their future, then they desperately try to make those people happy some way. And if they can't, then they work on themselves, say, what do I need to do with myself to make them happy? And then they run into this continuity fear issue, and then they try to solve it quickly, and they can't, and they try harder, more. They get burned out. You burn out. You get, your mind won't stop. It's horrible. So this has to be, you know, seen, this dynamic, this how it goes like this needs to be recognized and seen. This is how it goes. So adults, well, you can't fake it with kids, you know. If suddenly your world is just like, wow. The advantage that those who are on the spiritual path, their kids, that the adults say, well, I'm not dependent on my future happiness for these, you know, out there. I'm, whatever happens, I still meditate. I'm still focused on this and you know, stable. And the kids see that, and then they say, oh, my parents, they're okay. So I don't have to do something extraordinary to make them happy. But when Kennedy got assassinated in the United States, I'm telling you, I didn't even understand. I was just a kid. I wasn't into politics or anything, but the reaction of the adults was such that I was just distraught. I said, wow, something has happened that is just absolutely terrible. Because at that point, you know, those who won World War II are now in charge. Kennedy was a veteran of World War II. And they felt that it was, they lived in the era of the United States as the greatest country in history, the global superpower, and our future was just unlimitedly bright and wonderful, and we would find this just spectacular happiness. There were rainbows dancing everywhere. Camelot, they called it. A golden age, an absolutely golden age, and we were it. And this is what I was brought up on. I was brought up in Camelot. We were it. We were the golden age, especially in California, in the United States, California. I mean, we were going to be just, you know, the golden child. We were the golden child. And then Kennedy, suddenly, he's assassinated. And Lyndon Johnson is now in control, and Camelot has died just like that. And of course, we had Jackie, you know, Jackie Kennedy, there as the princess of Camelot, the queen of Camelot, and she was so sophisticated and stylish. You know, she was so steeped in European, like aristocracy. It's kind of like we had our king and queen, and they would reign forever. And everything was so working so well, it seemed like. Vietnam hadn't gotten real bad at that time, right? And so the loss of Kennedy just devastated the psyche, the deep psyche of everyone here. So we pin our hopes upon these leaders. People pin their hopes on them. And just like I've taken this nasty fall, even if you don't pin your hopes on them, if others do, you're going to feel their pain and suffering. Also, moods are contagious. So even if you say, it doesn't bother me, I didn't like them anyway. But the overall mood of the country, just that bounce in our step, you know, was lost. We had this bounce to ourselves, and the confidence was intoxicating at that time. I said, you know, we want to go to Hawaii, let's go down to the airport, you know, pack our things, okay, we're going to go and get our tickets, walk into the airport, walk onto the plane, go to Hawaii. Nobody questions Americans at that point. Nobody questioned us. Our passport was golden, you know, but we could feel like we'd go anywhere. Our money was strong. Everything was just humming. And then we realized it's not humming anymore. And it's never been the same. Uh-oh. I was wondering if I would get this call. Yeah, 1 second, please. So keep in mind that we're still coming down from this wow, okay? So I'm just talking about some, you know, less intense issues as we sort of cool down from the wow. This is exactly how to practice. You stay engaged with the dynamics of your situation. We're now talking about this world now. Why is it so important to practice? People have desperate hopes for the future here, desperate hopes. I can tell you that is for sure. The conservatives are absolutely desperate. My personal opinion, how I read the tea leaves, is the conservatives in this world are going to be really crushed. I don't believe they're going to make a resurgence. I believe that this is written on the wall that they're going to be crushed. This is a terrible thing, actually. Terrible. One way or another, the momentum is on the side of the progressives now. And this is on the side of smartness. And when smartness reigns, you're headed for a drastic fall in the world. There's no question about it. You may not recognize the drastic fall because you think, I'm just keep being smart and everything's okay. It's like, let me just ignore the continuity fear, and if I ignore it long enough, it'll go away. And we think, well, that's a real smart strategy. Great strategy. Great answer. Looking for ignore continuity fear. It's not there. Let's play the feud. So, again, world full of smart people think, let's just ignore this. That'll work. Oh, yeah. And so they ignore it for a long time. And they think, we're succeeding. We're progressing. Until something happens that They need to optimize themselves, and they say something's in the way. What's this in the way? I shouldn't be in the way. There shouldn't be anything there at all. And yet there's this terrible dread, and they say, "What the heck? Okay, let me fix it. Doesn't work. Let me fix it. Doesn't work. Doesn't work. Doesn't work." And they keep on trying to fix it. Like this, it doesn't work. Doesn't work. Doesn't work. What's going on? And then the mind starts panicking. So ultimately, a smart world is going into what's called a panic mode, ultimately. It's worse than depression, when you panic. Psychotic reactions is what happens. And then the wheels really come off. The depression, yeah, you can still schlep along and you're functioning, but you just feel like, I'm so defeated, I'm so tired, I keep thinking, trying to do, and but at least you can still read, you can still think, you can still do stuff. But when you have a psychotic reaction from panicking, it's a different story. Then things get real rough. So this is what a smart world is headed towards, really rough waters. You don't want to go there. Do not want to go there. But they get into those rough waters by pretending that, like, hey, if I ignore it, it'll disappear. So nothing there to see. Nothing there to see. Nothing there to see. Whistling past the graveyard. Nothing there to see. And I'm being real smart. I'm being as smart as I can be. And they say, well, I just got to push it farther and farther, farther, farther down the road, and then eventually it'll just won't be there anymore. I just got lucky. It's gone. It doesn't disappear that way. It gets worse. It gets worse. Got to pay the piper at some point. So that's what we're headed towards. And so they want to crush the conservatives. Progressives want to crush them, as they have done throughout the world in many ways already. Thinking that they know best. Progressives believe they know best. Well, they don't. They don't know best. They're pursuing a futile, dangerous strategy, actually, of just ignoring this continuity fear, since they can't fix it quick enough, to they call it self-esteem smartness. In other words, if it hurts their self-esteem to work on this problem, oh no, that hurts our self-esteem. We can't touch that. Let's just pretend it's not there. Yeah, it's not important. So just push it off to the side more and more. They marginalize more and more. Okay, let's just ignore this now. Let's just socially, society, just agree that we're all just going to ignore this and pretend it doesn't exist. And anyone who thinks about this is crazy. And yeah, let's just do that. That's smart. So you get all these smart people coming up with these smart solutions that are just drastically wrong. Pass to take drastically. And conservatism goes slower at it. Says, oh, wait a minute, maybe this is going to take a longer time to fix this. This might be a real bad problem. Let's not go too fast, and let's not jump to too many conclusions here. Let's keep some values here that are like patience, a little more, austerity, a little more patience, and let's not, be too hasty. Be more conservative. Let's not get overconfident about our ability to solve these problems. Maybe, some of the wisdom of ancient times passed down to us, maybe some of that wisdom is really accurate, saying you might need to really work at this for like a long time. Maybe your whole life should be dedicated to this. Oh, that's nails on a chalkboard to the progressives. It's all about faster. So you have this inherent conflict between the conservatives and progressives, and the progressives are winning the conflict. And the progressives are very clever indeed. They're smart and clever, yeah. Don't put anything past them. They'll sabotage themselves if it will help them crush the conservatives. They will. It's a black flag. They'll throw up a black flag event if it helps them, just like the Nazis did, who are actually very strong progressives. Reichstag fire. they set it themselves, blamed it on the communists, helped them sweep them to power and be able to declare basically kind of martial law type suspend, you know, the laws of the Constitution. We're under attack. We've got these dangerous, you know, horrible, dangerous enemies who are willing, are sabotaging the motherland, the fatherland, and both probably. And so we have to just, you know, declare extraordinary emergency law situation. We got to go after them, this, this, and that, and there you go. But so they sabotage themselves. So they're willing to sacrifice something in order to gain big. So they can pin it on the opposition and then attack the opposition and crush the conservatives. So a black flag event is very possible right now. It's very possible. The likelihood for one, it grows and grows every day, actually. Because their goal is to eradicate conservatism and just have this whole cult of speed and smartness and quickness. And let's get the answers faster and faster and faster. Let's make progress, progress, progress. Progressives means to progress, progress. Conservatives say, wait a minute, you know, let's not be in too much of a hurry. Let's go play golf and maybe we should just leave well enough alone some stuff here. Let's not, right? Slow things down a little bit. Probably be good for us. So there you have it. And so a black flag event is, this would, black flag event would be the progressives, some aspect of the progressives will sacrifice one of their own, sabotage themselves in some way, then blame it on the conservatives. And then that way marshal massive outrage towards the conservatives to help crush them. Perfect setup for a black flag event right now. Perfect setup. So, we have to be cognizant of this. Conservatives don't want to be crushed. I mean, even if for instance, Trump doesn't win, they don't want to be crushed. They'll say, well, we'll try again. You know, Hillary will be a lousy president. Well, next election, we'll win. Okay, that's what they're thinking, right? They've got empowered. They've got a little momentum. So, Trump's helped them with that, and so they're looking ahead to 2020 already. And the progressives know that, and they may know that Hillary will be a lousy president, terrible. And so they're saying, hey, you know, we don't want the conservatives to regain momentum at all. So we want to crush them right now, really bring them to their knees and crush them. So don't think that they aren't strategizing in that way. That mindset, that type of mindset will strategize in that way. So they may say, let's sacrifice Hillary now. And maybe Trump won't win anyway. But the amount of outrage, if we can blame the conservatives for that, the amount of outrage towards them will just devastate them forever. They'll never recover from it. And maybe, who knows, Bernie, they may be bringing Bernie Sanders, or they may bring in somebody else, or I don't know, or they may declare martial law and keep 44 in there, or something. The black flag events are used throughout history by these smart folks to wipe out the opposition, to galvanize public outrage is what they're after. That's what the Nazis did. Same mentalities at work here in the United States, right? On the Nazi mentalities at work. Same mentality. Now, will it happen? We all adamantly insist that it not, actually. It would be a disaster for the country and for the world, actually. And for the mental health of the world going forward, long-term mental health, it would be a disaster. This is why the Dharma Kings have called the global mental health alert. Meaning the potential for severe trouble is there, actually. Very much a potential. And I think it's Hillary is the one who's in most danger. Something maybe from the right, but also from the left, actually. More so from the left. They may sacrifice her for a greater gain, actually. Don't put that past them at all. These are Zelenskyites, after all. That if you can generate a crisis to crush the opposition, that's what you're supposed to do. That's what you're supposed to do. That's being smart. See, that's being smart. That's Zelensky, Zelensky. This terrible influence in the world. Radical influence of just no conscience, so unscrupulous. Just this is how you defeat, you know, that what you want to defeat by hook or by crook. Generate crises, foment these crises, etc. It's just awful. Machiavellianness, terrible Machiavellian attitude. That's what 44 was, you know, that's his guy. And that's what he lives and breathes. Is Machiavellianness. He's Machiavellian, to say the least. The left is very Machiavellian. So the progressives. So nothing has changed throughout history. It's the exact same thing. You just have to be aware of trends. And this is a setup. We're in a setup now for this sort of thing to play out. Yeah, again, they say that this politics is such an extraordinarily dirty business, and it is. Is the powers behind the scene will sacrifice someone in order to gain a greater good to crush the opposition. They will do that, and they just think that this is natural. This is what smartness does. Smartness is good. Smartness is our purpose. And so we're just fulfilling our purpose in progressing. This helps the overall progression. So this is justified. It's righteous and justified. So we pray that nothing happens. That we're aware or on alert that a black flag event could happen. It is the perfect setup for it right now. If ever there was a setup for a black flag event, it's now. Somebody, again, attacking their own interests to a limited extent in order to gain a much greater advantage in the longer term. And then by blaming the opposition that they're the ones who attacked, galvanizing public outrage towards their opposition, and then really crushing them in that way. Way more crushing than an election victory would be. I don't think they're after an election victory. Obviously, the United States is polarized half and half. They don't want that. They want to dominate. So they want to galvanize public opinion against the conservatives. And Trump's a very easy guy to use for that purpose, to hate on. So they've got it all set up for a black flag event, actually. So we have to be very wise at this point. And this global mental health alert the Dharma Kings have issued. Now, how'd they issue that? Well, I issued it. Well, how can I do that? Well, I work for them. And how come I work for them? Well, I told you that right practice, knowing how to practice in the right way, is very valuable. That's what they look for. I can be relied upon a long-term basis. And I can advance, and you know, it's a good investment for them, very great investment. And I've been this very much a super enthused amateur mental health expert for my whole life. I had to focus on it. I was in such trouble myself. So I am, you know, vastly well read and versed, and it's my hobby, it's my passion in life, is mental health. So I'm still an amateur, you know, hobbyist. I'm not a pro, but they asked me to go pro. So that's the transition that I've been working on is to go pro, meaning get some real responsibility. So you start out as an enthusiast, and then sometimes enthusiasts, you know, they become professional at what they're enthused about, if they really, that's really what they want to do. And so that's what I'm good at. So I'm in this going professional mode of taking some little responsibilities here and there, and declaring that mental health alert is something that I felt is a responsibility. I got this very strong, sudden impression that this is what's happening. So get it out there. Get it out there. And I immediately did so. So I'm getting used to this going pro-ness. I don't know what it all entails or anything, but I've shifted over from just an amateur to a pro at this point. Can't stay an amateur forever. What good's that? I gotta go pro. Going amateur is less pressure, right? But going pro, I'm sure, has its advantages too. A lot of advantages. Higher profile in some way, maybe in the long run. Like a skateboarder, like a really good skateboarder. Nobody knows about him. Then somebody does a film on them. Everybody sees them, and then the skate companies say, wow, we want him to skate for our team and sell a lot of merchandise. And they ask him if you want to go pro and pay him a lot of money. People are telling me that these skateboard companies, they pay a lot of money to these top skaters because the kids see them in all sorts of videos and exposure and signature boards and clothing and all this stuff. And the kids say, oh man, I want to be like him. Just saw a recent video of one of these young skaters who apparently has gone pro now. I don't know, was he 18 or he's not very old. Boy, oh wow, is he good. Yeah, he's really good. There's a few of them, they're just really, really good. They have their own style, they have their own tricks, they invent new tricks, and they're just really amazing acrobats. And the kids, you can't be like that, actually. Not many could even get close to that. These guys, these are like super, super acrobats using a skateboard. So going pro, it is you get more exposure in some way, more certain responsibilities. You have to be obligated if you're a contract, pro contract. You have some rules, regulations, and rules, and so that you realize that you got to be serious about this. You represent the company, etc., like that. So, it's a new chapter in my life, going pro. It's a new chapter. But the thing is, we're in this global mental health alert. You got to go pro. For me, I have to go pro in order to help out. This is, again, you have to go be proactive now. You have to be active like a pro. This is one way of putting it. Be active like a pro. Call upon the pro in you, the real pro. Call upon that and say, I got to be active like a pro right now. No more amateur stuff. I really got to shift gears here. Really have to shift gears. So this is what I'm calling everyone to do, is to really just shift gear and say, I have to have lightning strike today. And I've got to start practicing in the right way. I've got to pick my game up just like immediately. No thinking about it, just do it. Now, I can think of so much stuff I could do, but it's how do you narrow it down to what's the right thing to do, right? So, could I make Again, can I make some very interesting videos? Yes, if that's required. Now, that fall I took is very instructive for me. There's no accidents. I did it on purpose. There's no question. I let my attention lapse on purpose, so I take a fall, and I found out that there's phases you go through in recovery. The fall, the kind of denial, think, oh, it's okay, brush yourself off, maybe I should start skating. Well, maybe I need to, take a little break here, and then you think, well, I'll probably be okay. I said, well, I'm a little banged up, no, it's not so bad. And then the next day, things start to hurt a little bit, and think, well, it's not so bad. And then the second day, then it sets in even more. So there's stages. It's the shock of the first fall, then the kind of like brushing it off, like, okay, it's no big deal. Then the third phase is, well, maybe it's worse than I thought. Then the fourth phase is, well, maybe it's not quite that bad. And the fifth phase is, uh-oh, it's pretty bad. And the sixth phase is, oh my gosh, this is like all over my body, and different parts of my body hurt, and I didn't think would hurt. I mean, this is the worst than I thought. And the seventh phase is, then it starts to cool down a bit, but you realize, yeah, I really got banged up pretty bad. And then the eighth phase is, I'm starting to body starting to, the ear, the inflammation, everything's starting to subside, and I'm feeling, better, but I'm still not, still not really 100%. Ninth phase is, getting back pretty much to normal. Still a little sore. The 10th phase is, okay, I feel pretty good now. All right, so you maybe go through like 10 different phases, and each one of those phases you might need different tactics to deal with, actually. So in a global crisis, mental health crisis, there may be, like I said, 10 different phases we're facing, and you have to know what phase we're in and how to deal with that particular phase. I do. Anyway, well, the Dharma Kings know. I have to be informed by them of what to do. So I don't know exactly what to do at this point. I just have to keep doing the best I can. At some point, I could do some videos. I'm my mind. I've already have all these ideas of could do, but some very funny, humorous, profound mixture, 360 degree approach, Dzogchen X approach to film. I really could. I'm just trying to set that up, but I don't want to focus too much on it because I don't feel right now I've got something else I have to take care of in terms of we have to. There's decisions. There's a lot of stuff I have to, some fundamental stuff I have to get lined up here quickly. So I'm trying to resist the urge to get in heavily into taping and editing and producing some of these real cute, video that's funny, and people say, wow, that was neat. Because at some, maybe some point, some phase, they'll like that, say, ah, this is great. But maybe right now, nah, it's not so important for them. So we'll see. I'm gearing up for it. In my mind, etc. Today I had a good singing voice. For a while I didn't. The last couple of days I have. I've been getting more sleep, so I don't feel so sluggish and tired. And able to hit the high notes in the Beach Boys the last couple of days. Isn't that something? Because I'm not over singing. I'm being conservative with my singing. And I'm able to get all the high notes. And I get around fun, fun, fun. All their songs where there's the Reed, Brian Wilson goes way up there. I mean, I gotta reach to get up there. But he gets up there strong. It's natural, he had this natural voice that way. He had kind of a mezzo soprano voice. And so, but if I don't strain my vocal cords and sing more quietly, I can do it. That's a lot of fun for me. I was like, wow, I could sing all those high parts of the Beach Boys again, like when I was young. That's I get a kick out of that, I'll tell you. So I'm just, every day I hope I can sing the high parts today. So don't let me strain too much. If I start really belting and singing loud, then it goes away. The vocal cords have to be tight. You can't stretch them out with strong singing. Then you can't get the high parts. They're just gone. So again, remember that we're sitting here because we caused quite a number of severe psychic earthquakes that our defenses just we realized, oh my gosh, I've been defending in just an absurdist way. This is so absurd what I've been doing. It is so absurd. It's completely absurd. My defenses are like completely absurd. Wow. That's what it boils down to, isn't it? My defenses are completely absurd. And we notice this, really. This is what produces the wow. We just recognize, wait a minute. I've built a house of straw. Completely based on straw, on absurdity. The whole notion of an I is built on absurdity. It's all on just absurdity, which has no sustaining power whatsoever. How long does it take to get rid of nothing? And then you just sit there and hope, like, I hope it doesn't all disappear right this instant. We're honoring our creativity and continuity fear, and it doesn't. But we realized it could. I mean, wow. It's easy. What do we have to do first to get rid of nothing? What are we waiting on? What kind of result are we waiting on to get rid of nothing? Like, what part of nothing do we have to first get rid of until we get rid of the rest of it? What part of nothing do we have to get rid of first before we can get rid of the rest of it? So now we're back into the assertions here, right? So you see, we've just sort of cycled through a practice like this. You start out, you see the absurdity of the defenses, you go through the wow. It settles down a little bit, then you start talking about stuff that's a little more generalized, and then you calm down enough until you get, then you loop back into more assertions. So then you're back in the wow again. Wow. What part of reality do we need to deal with first before we deal with the rest of it? What part of nothing? I'm sorry, did I say reality? What part of nothing? What part of nothing do we need to get rid of first before we get rid of the rest of it? Now, clearly, we're like, whoa, wait a minute. It's an absurdity, isn't it? How can nothing have parts? How can if there's no parts, how can there be a get rid of a first part and then get rid of a second part? So, how can there be a process to get rid of nothing? And if there's no process, how can it take time? And if there's no parts to it, nothing, how could there be form to it? Right? So, and then where could all this non-action be taking place? Do we need some space for to get rid of nothing? How much space do we need to play out getting rid of nothing? Time, space, process, and form. So we're back in the wow. What does Longchenpa do? He just points out the absurdity of our position. And just from every angle, just showing us it's not like that. I mean, it's the way we see it is absurd, and I see it this way. This is not absurd. So if we are practicing seeing it as absurd, though in the wow, that's exactly what the practice we need to do. It's quite a reaction when we see absurdity like this. It's a wow. It's a wow. that's so heavy, intense, shocking. And deep down we know, oh my gosh, that's what I've been using. I've been totally falsifying taking this absurdity seriously. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh, right? Wow. Don't say, oh my, don't put a negative light, put it in a neutral light, just wow. Don't take it either positive nor negative. Refuse to go either direction. No oscillation. Because when we see absurdity, we say, but that's never going to work. I got to divest myself of this. So that changes our future, the expectations of our future radically change. When we divest ourselves of a major absurdity, that, again, very much changes our expectations of how we're going to be functioning in the future. Very much so. A lot of pivoting taking place. What part of now do I need to get rid of first, and then so I can get rid of the rest of it? So what comes first and what comes second? Is there any first and second? R is the only way to drop reality. You got to drop nothing in favor of reality. The only way to drop nothing is to drop nothing. To drop the belief that there's anything to get rid of, there's any steps, any time, space, process, form required to drop the notion of nothing. Finally Friday, huh? I didn't get enough work this week, terrible. So I have to really get after it here. And again, if for those who practice in the right way like this, nothing can stop you. And you know it. You know you've got the secret. For those who don't practice in this way, no amount of smartness is going to save you, will save you. No amount of smartness. Doesn't matter how much you think you know, who you know, whatever. If you cannot practice in the proper way like this, you're just going to, ultimately you're going in a negative spiral. Continuity fear is still getting worse. Ignoring it doesn't make it go away. Temporarily it might seem that way, but it's always there, and it's showing up in so many, many different ways. And you think, oh, I've got so many different problems. No, we just have this one problem being denied, showing up in many, many ways, that since we deny it, we say, well, this can't be all the same problem. It has to be all different problems. So we end up seeing all these different problems, but it's really just one problem, the continuity fear problem. Whew, how are we doing here? I don't know. 140? What? Come on. Seriously? No. Is that true? I already bet this 1 hour and 40 minutes. Oh my gosh, I don't know. That's amazing. I'm a little tired. I'm tired. I'm not getting enough rest. There's a problem. I'm waking up early in the morning. I think I should go out and tape. You know, go out and tape. And I say, no. Let's nail down these issues here. That's more important. And people want to be entertained. They don't know how to practice properly. They want to be entertained. There's a lot of pressure on me. Like, you know, come on. Do something that can help me. Well, only right practice can ultimately help you. Don't let your superficial mind drift into storylines, drama, thoughts, and everything. Just dismiss them. They'll rise, but just don't follow them. Oh no, I need to be, you know, focused on what I'm doing here. This is a very important practice, and just catch yourself. Of course, they will continue to rise. The mind's always active, isn't it? So, we've done a great practice here. This is all that's required. You do this and you will advance. You know, that's not all that's required. It's the essential element that's required. And then we continue 24/7 feeding our spiritual, you know, awakening to recognize, oh, the pretend self isn't a real self. Right? Just because we pretend to be nothing doesn't mean there's some real nothing there. Just because we say that the I is nothing. Well, it's not nothing. It's just us pretending. We're just pretending to be this I. There's no real I there at all. It's just us spirits pretending. There's no dynamic to a pretend self. Sometimes it doesn't have its own. It's just pretense. And again, you could, you know, pretend to be dead. And then you decide, oh, I'm going to stop pretending to be dead, and you jump up. I can be in the gutter, lying out there dead, and think pretending to be dead, and people think he's dead. And it's like, ah, just pretending. We used to play that joke, just pretending. That's all we're doing. We're just pretending. So if you're lying there in a gutter dead, what dynamics are you under? What are you? Are you under any dynamics at all, other than pretending? So in other words, I want to jump up now and be lively, alive again. Oh no, wait a minute, I can't do that. Oh, my body's decaying, you know, it's dead. Muscles don't work. I'm not able to move. I have no consciousness. I can't do any of that. No. What? Jesus said, get up, Lazarus, you know, stop pretending to be dead. That's ridiculous. Lazarus said, oh yeah, okay, all right, I remember now. Yeah, I'm pretending, okay. Yeah, there's no dynamic that has a hold of you. Yeah, but everybody pretends there is, so we all think we keep pretending, think of all these laws of nature, you know, that have a hold of us. There's a collective pretense, so it seems very convincing, doesn't it? So, I mean, just because, what is this? Still going. Yeah, it's still going. Cruising along. Okay, so we're coming out of it. You know, we could go another cycle, right? Another wow cycle. If I start talking non-dual, showing the absurdity, you'd feel, oh, that's absurd. Oh my gosh, that's what I'm doing. That's what I've been doing for so long. Oh, wow. There's no way that could work, you know, like that. But you don't want to burn out. You want to be able to, you know, be, as you go along, like for me the rest of the day, I'm sure it'll come, much more stuff will come up. Very profound stuff comes up, like on Facebook. Facebook has its moments, you know, if you get out of what you put into it. You put into it something, and it's like, wow. But what's absent? Right practicing. For the most part, right practicing. That's almost an orphan right now in the world. Why? Smartness. We live in the age of smartness, which is the worst age to live in of all. Doesn't end well going that direction, as we have pointed out. Drug companies will do well. Alcohol companies, you know, whatever, you know, sex industry will do well. Therapist industry will do well in terms of psychotherapy industry. Just all manner of stuff will do well as people try to self-medicate and think, wow, Why do I feel so weird? Why do I feel? What's the trouble here? What's the trouble? Yeah. It's and then very crazy reactions could very well, psychotic reactions become the norm. You're expected to follow along. Really? We've already had that, like in the, the 80s. Every decade it seems to go cuckoo, at some point. So we're due for that in this decade, aren't we? It's 2016s already. We're definitely due for it. You get swept up in that, different decades. I mean, the late 70s and the 80s, cocaine. Oh, it was just horrible. Everybody just got swept up in that. Not everyone, but the culture in general just got into this, just nuts. This is what you did if you were progressive. It's why it's a great speed up drug. It speeds you up, makes you faster, makes you smarter. So this is, this is what they thought. Wow, this is great. The modern society, based on high technology, was fueled by caffeine and cocaine. The smart drugs makes you feel smarter, makes you want to go faster, develop faster stuff, get quicker answers. It's the whole thing here. It's what it's all the modern world's all about, getting quicker answers. And yet, we're here, not so much trying to get answers, but allowing the continuity fear to evaporate. That takes a while. It's gradual. So, evaporating continuity fear is gradual. Enlightenment is sudden. It's all at once, because there are no parts to nothing. So you can't get rid of this part of nothing first. It's not like that's the first step of enlightenment, and here's the second one. And now you're in it like that, and it's just there. It's total, holistic. You just say, oh, this is the way everything, this is the way it is. But you just glide into it imperceptibly. Just glide into it. It doesn't feel like some, volcano erupting or anything. It's just one moment you didn't have, the next moment you have it. Because you just realize that it doesn't take any time to get rid of nothing. You accepted it briefly, and then you're just there. So whatever insights you have to practice, you need to practice in this way, because it will shock you to the core that you see the absurdity. When you see the absurdity and you realize your foundation, your mental foundation has been resting upon absurdity, I mean, I don't know what else is more shocking than that. But then you realize, I don't want to keep doing that, because that's crazy. That's going to cause me severe troubles. So you realize, wow, I've got to transfer my foundation off of that, off of absurdity, back onto truth. So, but wow, it seems like too much of a radical shift. And oh my gosh, what do I do? And just say, okay, let this settle down, and then once it settles down, then we'll take another look. Once this settles down, then we'll take another look. Don't worry. So it's like that. I'm not under any pressure to look more deeply again. Once it settles down, then we'll see how I feel. If I feel like taking a deeper look, I'll take a deeper look. So you be very patient with yourself. You be conservative in your speed and your pressure. You say, once this settles down, then we'll see how I feel. You're not committing to take another deeper look. You're just saying, I'm not ruling it out, not saying yes or no, but I'll just settle down first, reassess, see how I feel, and then go from there. Just like that. Very conservative, right? So Friday, what do I do now? I don't know. I don't know. I don't. It all depends, on how this settles down and how do I feel. So I don't structure the future, because when you structure the future, you pretty much rule out the wow. You're pretty saying much saying, I've got the foundation. My foundation's solid. So let me now structure what I'm going to do with this great solid foundation. This is progressivism. They think they've got the right foundation. They don't. They don't at all. Conservatives saying, maybe I don't have such a great foundation. So let me not extrapolate too much here. And for B, I'm even more cautious. I would say I don't want to structure my future at all because I'm aware that my foundation is based on absurdity. I may see it like that, and my foundation then is going to shift to truth. I don't know how to assess the future. How am I going to function? I don't know. And I'm not going to even try to plan it out at all. Let me just keep working like I'm working and just take it one moment at a time. See how I feel. See what I'm up for. Haven't been able to sing for like a week. I didn't have it. And then last couple of days it started to come back again. So, don't force it. If it's not there, don't force it. So again, this is how you get the attention of the Dharma kings, those who know what to look for. They're looking for just this. How are we able to practice recognizing the absurdity within us and recognizing that we have to set it down? Are we able to practice that, recognizing that our foundation is based on absurdity? Are we able to recognize it, to see it, clearly see it? You have to be able to do that in order to help out. Otherwise, you'd just be passing on absurdity, you know? So, it's pretty simple, isn't it? It's very simple. You just have to do it. And doing it is easy. It's just that you might think you're falling behind. Like, I'm not solving problems fast. Well, continuity fear is not a problem you can really solve fast. You can see something's absurd instantly, but your familiarity with this, thinking this is what I am, I can't let go of this, or what would happen, that doesn't yield so easily. Familiarity doesn't yield so easily at all. It's very stubborn. You have to be very patient and kind and work with it and know how to manage the whole thing so you don't panic yourself, don't push yourself too much. Don't go too slow, don't go too fast. Don't go too slow, don't go too fast. Like that. And you smooth it out, become better and better at it. I can do it for what, 2 hours at a stretch, 2.5 hours, 3 hours at a stretch. Just I'm used to it. I do it every day. And you get better and better and better, you go faster and faster and faster, make more and more progress. And the Dharma kings say, hey, you know, we really need your help here. We like, help us out, please. We need every bit of help we can get. So it's not like you're super special. No, they need every bit of help they can get. So if you can help them, they're going to say, hey, we really need your help. Because there are these, like I said, 10 phases. I just threw that out there. It's a good round number. There might be 10. There might be as many as 10 phases or more. I don't know, of working through this, mental health. Potential mental health crisis, potential black flag event coming up. Whatever happens in the world, it's set up to really cause quite a bit of reactions, different phases of reactions, and helping in different ways. What people want now, later on they don't want, and you have to be very flexible, shift this direction, that direction to help out. So I keep working at this. So I advise everyone to take this to heart. Just keep on, keep on listening, listening. At some point, you'll get with it. Just keep on taking this in and just say, yeah, I'm getting familiar with this. But remember, keep in mind that smartness can't solve it. So at some point, you're going to have to go beyond your smartness and realize it really is a second tier sort of thing. It's really in defense of this imaginary self I that is just us pretending to be this I, to be an I, some other self than what we are. We're pretending to be a second self, and then trying to, once we get caught, we try to integrate the two. Say, oh, no, this is all God's plan. We have two selves, integrate the two selves. Now that integration, we got a third self. Oh, yeah. That smartness again, just playing fast and loose with the facts. Okay. Ah, we hit 2 hours. Can you believe that? Just like that. Be a spiritual athlete ultimately, but just do a little. Just start. I don't know how to say to start. It's up to everyone. Smart Sally says, I gotta do it fast. 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 So how do I do it fast? Just recognize an absurdity and then feel the reaction and say, wow, I need to let this cool down. This is really disturbing me at some level. I'm really quite shocked by this. And I don't want to take sides on it. Don't take sides. Just let it cool down. Don't take sides. Very great. All right, that's enough. Did a great job. And then, you know, it's for me, you know, it's for you, for me. It's on to the next great job, so to speak. So I have bigger wows in store. Right? Yeah, we all do. So we better keep working on this because there's a lot of wows coming down the road. And we just take one at a time and we'll be fine. One at a time. We'll be fine. There's a nice little mantra. One other time, we'll be fine. Very great. That's it. Stop catcher.